Welcome back to Learning Journal. In the previous video, I talked about file-based data sources. I also promised to cover some more Spark data sources. To keep my promise, I intend to demonstrate three more Spark data sources: JDBC, Cassandra, MongoDB. Covering all of them in a single video is not possible. So, I plan to break them into three videos. In this video, I will talk about Spark JDBC connector. So, let's start. Spark JDBC connector is one of the most valuable connectors for two reasons. You can connect to a variety of databases. Some of the most popular options are Oracle, SQL Server, MySQL, and the PostgreSQL. In fact, you can connect to any database that offers SQL and supports a JDBC connectivity. The second and the most important reason to use JDBC data source is a use case that might need you to connect to an RDBMS. Let's try to understand one of the use cases. Assume that you are a media and information company that publishes content over various channels. Your customers are viewing that material, and you are collecting necessary data. You have millions of viewers, and hence, you get a massive amount of data. It may be a couple of terabytes per month, right? You ingest that data to your data lake and want to aggregate and summarize it. Then, you want to build a set of dashboards for different stakeholders in your organization. The dashboarding application gives them an opportunity to slice and dice the results and gain some insight into what is performing well and which themes are trending, right? However, you realize that the dashboarding is an independent application for two reasons. The output of your aggregation and summarization is sufficient enough to power that application. It also needs a bunch of other features. For example, user management, login credentials, user preferences, save and download reports, share reports and collaborate with other colleagues, and many other things. This kind of application makes more sense with an RDBMS as a backend, right? So, you decided to add an RDBMS. Now, it's apparent that you need to connect to an RDBMS from Apache Spark and save your aggregation output in the RDBMS. That's it. That's what makes a Spark JDBC connector a critical thing, isn't it? I hope you understand that you might want to read something into Spark from an RDBMS, and you might also need to write something back to a relational database. How to do it? That's what I am going to demonstrate. I'll use Postgres for this demo. However, it should work with any JDBC compliant database with some minor changes. I need a Postgres database for my demo. So, let's start a Postgres VM in Google Cloud. Start your GCP console. Go to Cloud Launcher. Search for Postgres. You might see multiple options. Choose the one that is labeled as Google Click to Deploy. Your Postgres usage is free, but you might incur some cost for the CPU and the memory. Click on the Launch button. You might want to change the zone to the same zone as you have for your Spark VM. You might also want to change the machine type to a smaller configuration. Finally, click this Deploy button. That's it. GCP will launch your VM in less than a minute. You can SSH to your Postgres server from the deployments page. Alternatively, you can come back to your Compute Engine page and SSH to the VM. Once you complete your testing, you can delete your VM and deployment. Before I can use this Postgres system, I need to set up few things. Create a Postgres user, create a database, and test Postgres server connection from a remote machine. Let's do that. The first step is to create a user. Use following command to create a user for yourself. The first command changes the current OS user to the Postgres Server admin user. The second command is a Postgres Server utility that creates a user. The first option will prompt password for the new user. The second option will ask some other necessary questions. The last argument is my username. Finally, exit to the regular user. The next step is to create database. Use the below command. Great. Now we need to test the connection from a remote machine. I want to make sure that I can connect to the Postgres DB from a different VM. However, I need to install a Postgres client tool for this testing. So, let's download and install a client tool. Go to www.postgresql.org. Click Downloads. Select your OS family. Choose the latest PostgreSQL version. Pick up the architecture. Copy and execute the yum install command. That command will configure your repository. Finally, install the client using the next yum command. Great! Now we are ready to test the Postgres remote connection. Use below command to connect to the remote Postgres database. You might want to change the IP address with your Postgres Server VM's IP address. You can get the IP address of your Postgres server using below command. Oops, remote connection is not working. To fix this problem, you need to modify Postgres HBA file. Let's do that. Great, it worked. All of this is not at all required if you already have a Postgres database server that allows connection from a remote machine. I had to do all this for the demo. However, all this exercise has nothing to do with Spark JDBC connectivity. All you need is following information. Your Postgres server IP, database listener TCP/IP port, and a database name. You might also need some credentials like username and password. If you already have these things, you can directly start your Spark shell and test your JDBC example. To use Spark JDBC connector, you need to download the JDBC connection jar and include it in your driver and executor class path. It sounds difficult, however, it is quite simple to achieve. Use below command to start the Spark shell. We need a JDBC driver package, and hence, I am adding it to my Spark class path using -- package option. I am going to connect to Postgres, and hence I am adding Postgres JDBC package. If you want to use Oracle or any other database, you should include the appropriate JDBC package for the respective database. As you already know, the -- package option will automatically pull the dependencies from the Maven repository and include it to your class path. Great! We are ready to write data from Spark over a JDBC connection. use following code. You already understand this code, right? We have used the same in an earlier video. The first part is reading data from a CSV source. Then we register that data frame as a temporary view. Then I perform some aggregation and create another data set using an SQL code. My output is available as a data frame. Let me show you the content of this data frame. Nice, isn't it? This data frame is what I want to save into my RDBMS. Here is the code to write it to JDBC database. The write API structure is the same as we used for other file formats in the earlier video. Let me explain it quickly. We define the format as JDBC. Then we set 5 different options. The driver, JDBC URL, database table name, and the credentials. That's it. Execute the save method and it goes to your database. You can go back to your Postgres client tool and verify it. Amazing, isn't it? It creates the table and loads the data. However, I don't prefer this automatic create table approach. I prefer to create the table directly in database using database create table statement. That gives me more control over the database design. However, you might be wondering, if the table already exists in the database, how will we truncate and write the data into the same table? If you already have a table in the database, you can use the overwrite mode with the truncate option. To use the truncate on an existing table, all you need to do is to set another option, truncate as true. That's it. And the API takes care of truncating the existing table and inserting all the data into the same table. Truncate and insert approach is reasonable because it allows you to keep database table structure intact along with all indexes. Great! That's all about writing to Postgres database. Reading from database is as simple as reading from a file. I have added some examples of reading data into Spark data frame from a Postgres database. You can try it yourself. The first example is to read a full table. It is not necessary to read a full table. You might want to read some part of the data using an SQL statement. I have an example for that as well. We used some of the conventional options for a JDBC connector. You can get a list of all available JDBC options in Spark documentation. I recommend that you go through these options at least once. We also have a JDBC shortcut API method. Check that out as well. It looks like the JDBC shortcut API offers some more flexibility to partition your data for a read operation. Great! Thank you very much for watching Learning Journal. Keep learning and keep growing.